Good morning. Hello, students. This is Dr. Hemlata, Associate Professor in Zoology, Maharani Science College for Women, Palace Road, Bangalore. So we shall be learning some aspects about ethology. What is ethology? The term ethology is derived from two Greek words, ethos, which means culture, and logos, which means study. So ethology is the study of the animal behavior. It is the scientific, biological, and specific study of animal behavior. When you say animal behavior, behavior means you should be able to identify some kind of a change in an animal to a stimulus. A stimulus can be either physical, like it can be the light, it can be sound, or it can be a chemical factor like a pheromone. So when an animal is exposed to any kind of a stimulus like the light or the sound or the chemical, what it does is it will show some response to the stimuli. This response is called as the behavior. Sometimes an animal will do some activity for which a second animal will show some response. Now, the first animal which is bringing about a response in the second one is releasing a behavior pattern in the second one. This is called as release of the behavior pattern. So when you say behavior, it means you should be able to see the changes what is exhibited by the animal. Those changes should be recognizable. Like it has to make a sound, or it should be able to express whatever it is feeling by communication, like what you see in higher forms like human beings, or it should move in response to the stimuli. Either a part of the body will move or the entire body will move, or they can exhibit some expressions on the face, they can walk away, or they can talk, they can show a change in the body posture, or simply they can stand still without showing any response. It's called as freeze reaction. There can be color change or release of a chemical substance. So whatever the animal is doing, why is it doing? It is doing for its own benefit. Like it has to survive. So the stimuli can be either beneficial or harmful. If it is beneficial, for example, let us say it has found the source of food, then it has to go and fetch the food. Or if it has found a mate, then they have to mate and reproduce. Or if they have produced young ones, they have to take care of the young one. They should protect the young one from the predator. If they come across a predator, they should run away from the predator. So these are all the responses what the animal will be showing for the benefit of itself. In this picture, you can see a group of monkeys. They are attracted by some kind of stimuli, and each one is showing a type of response. So what you are seeing here is the response of the monkeys to the stimulus. So what is behavior? When an animal is exposed to a stimulus, it is showing a response. So behavior results in so many other aspects. For example, when an animal is exposed to a new stimuli, then it will show a different type of response. A classical example for this is the moth Bistan betularia, which was seen in United Kingdom. This moth was a light colored moth which would settle on the bark of the trees, and it would merge with the background color and was not identifiable by the predator. Because of industrialization, carbon soot deposited on the bark of the trees, and the light colored moth was easily identifiable by the predator, and it was picked up by the predator. So what the moth did was it started developing some dark colored pigments and became darker in color, so that it was not identifiable when it settled on the black colored background. It merged with the background. By doing this, it showed an adaptation because of which it could survive. So it resulted, this adaptation resulted in the variation. What the variation here you see is the light colored moth became dark colored, and these variations was passed on to the next generation, and hence it became inheritable. So with such adaptations, which can be carried to other generations, the species will become best equipped and they have greater chances of survival, and hence the perpetuation of the race will continue. So the adaptations and inheritance results in differential reproduction and hence the survival of the race. A lot of people have contributed to the study of behavioral biology. Some of the pioneers who started their work in the field is, to name a few, Julian Huxley, who worked with birds, was an ornithologist. Conrad Lorenz and Nicholas Tinbergen, again ornithologists. Carl von Frisch, entomologist. William Morton Wheeler, also an entomologist. They conducted a lot of experiments with birds and insects and understand the behavioral aspects. So now, if you see what could be the cause of the behavior, there are two causes. Let us say an animal is hungry. So what it will do? It will try to find food and eat. So this is the cause, which is for the immediate need, and it is called as the proximate cause. For the purpose of survival, it has to eat. That is the proximate cause. But what is the ultimate cause? It has to eat, grow, mature, and reproduce. And by doing that, it has to perpetuate the race. That is the ultimate cause. So the behavior, whatever the animal is doing, for the immediate causes for the survival, and the ultimate causes to perpetuate the race. So with this introduction, we will see why is it important to study ethology. Basically, people were interested and they were really fascinated looking at the life in the wild. They used to wonder, looking at the behavioral aspects of the wild animals, they became inquisitive and they tried to find out what could be the reasons scientifically. For example, if you look at the birds, birds show migration, wherein the birds travel from one part of the world and they fly thousands of kilometers, covering more than 18,000 kilometers, reaching a different part of the world. So people were really fascinated from where are they coming and where are they going. So they really wanted to understand what could be the reason. So they wanted to know the reason, and hence they started studying about the behavioral aspects of the animals. Farmers definitely need to have information, because they rear a lot of animals and they do domesticate the animals. definitely knowing the behavior of these will be helpful for them, like when they are rearing silkworms or honeybee or fishes, knowing the behavior will definitely help them a lot. A hunter, a layman cannot go out hunting. It is very important for the hunter to have an experience or some information about the behavior so that he can explore the forest and go for hunting. It's also important to control the pests like the insects or rodents, and national park and zoo workers, they need to understand the behavioral aspects to maintain the animals. And also, if you have pets, if you know the behavior of your pets, it becomes easier to handle them. The study of behavior is a lot of time consuming and requires a lot of patience. So if you look at the wildlife videos, those videos, when they have been shot, it's not an easy job. They need a lot of time, because behavioral aspect is not a display when you can go and shoot whatever you want. You have to sit there and wait. When the animals do such kind of display, you should be able to shoot it. So what you see easily within few minutes would have taken hours or days or even months for a behavior biologist to capture it. So if you look at the types of animal behavior, there are two main types of animal behavior. The first is the innate or inherent behavior. Second is learned or acquired behavior. Under the innate or inherent behavior, which is also called a stereotype behavior, we will be learning kinesis, taxis, reflexes, instincts and motivation. Under acquired or learned behavior, we'll be learning imprinting, habituation, trial and error learning. So first of all, we'll start with the stereotype behavior. What is stereotype behavior? The behavior which helps the animal to attend to its basic needs, like to find the food or to escape from the enemies or to reproduce, such behavior is called as the stereotype behavior. You can see a highly coordinated, organized responses of the animal, or very unorganized, poor responses of the animals. This depends upon the complexity of the nervous system. The invertebrates like sponges exhibit poor or unorganized responses, whereas a vertebrate which has got a well-developed brain shows highly coordinated response to the stimulus. So we will be doing all the different types of behavior under stereotype. We'll see one by one. Stereotype behavior. So when an animal is exposed to a stimuli, it shows a response. So for one type of response, the stimuli is always the same. So for one response, how many ever times the animal is exposed to that, the response will be the same. This is called as repeated pattern of behavior. So the behavior is bound to the stimulus. The stimulus generally is from the environment. The stimulus will trigger response, and the response will be in a sequence. At the response, what it is showing is inherent, means all the animals belonging to one species will exhibit the same kind of response to the stimuli. So it is passed on from one generation to another. It is species specific. It can show adaptation. It is unlearned. It will not forget the behavior, and it shows fixed action pattern. What do you mean by fixed action pattern? We will take an example of egg rolling behavior in grey lag goose. In this slide, you can see the grey lag goose. In the picture, there are four sequences. In the first one, the grey lag goose has laid eggs in the nest, and accidentally, if the egg rolls out of the nest, then what the grey lag goose does is, it walks towards the egg, it puts its beak in front of the egg, and it brings the egg below its neck. The egg is now between the beak and the neck, and it starts rolling the egg until it comes back to the nest. This is the behavior pattern, sequence of behavior pattern, what the gray-legged goose shows when the eggs rolls out. So this pattern is a fixed action. Whenever the egg rolls out of the nest, the bird will roll it back to the nest. This kind of pattern is called as fixed action pattern, and this response is triggered by a stimulus. The stimulus is rolling out of the egg. The egg is rolled out of the nest. That is the stimulus, called as the sign stimulus, and the response is the fixed action pattern exhibited by gray-legged goose in rolling the egg back to the nest. So it was Jacques Loeb who coined the term tropism. So he defined that tropism is the response of the animal to the stimulus by showing movements. So this type of movement which the animal shows to the response is called as spatial orientation. Under spatial orientation, there are two types. One is called as kinesis, second one is called as taxis. In kinesis, when the animal is exposed to a stimulus, it starts moving, but the movement is random. It may accidentally go towards the stimuli or away from the stimuli. So it is an unoriented random movement. Such a type of unoriented random movement is called as kinesis. The second one is taxis. In this, when the animal is exposed to a stimulus, it will either go towards the stimuli if it is beneficial, or it goes away from the stimuli if it is harmful. So this type of oriented movement, either towards or away from the stimuli, is called as taxis. If it is going towards, you call it as positive taxis. If it is going away, you call it as negative taxis. So in this picture, you are seeing the response of a planaria, which is a flat worm, example for platyhelminthes. So whenever it is exposed to a food source, it moves towards the food source. It is a positive movement. And in the second one, you can see euglena. So whenever euglena comes across light, it starts moving towards the light, because it is having chlorophyll, it can synthesize its own food, it needs light, and it goes towards the light. So it shows positive taxis. Because it's moving towards the light, it is called as positive phototaxis. There are different types of taxis depending upon the source of the stimuli. If the stimuli is light, you call it as phototaxis. You call it as geotaxis when the stimuli is center of gravity, specific gravity of the earth. Hydrotaxis, that is the source is towards water, either towards or away from the water. Chemotaxis, stimuli is chemical. Aerotaxis, the stimuli is oxygen rich environment. Barotaxis, when the stimuli is related to pressure. Galvano or electrotaxis for electric current. Magnetotaxis for magnetic field. Animotaxis for wind. Rheotaxis for water current. So under the types of taxis, you have different subtypes. We will see what are the subtypes which are seen in different forms of animals. So you are seeing some in the invertebrate species, where the central nervous system is not well developed and the receptors are not as well developed as you see in vertebrates. The receptors can be symmetrical or asymmetrical. It can be very simple, like a shaded eye spot. In such cases, how the animal behaves to the response, you have different subtypes. The first one is clinotaxis. In this case, the photoreceptors are asymmetrical. When the photoreceptors are asymmetrical, the animal receives different stimuli on different parts of the body. So what it has to do, it has to move this way, that way, it has to compare the light intensity, and then it has to make a decision where it has to go. This type of movement is called as clinotaxis, as shown in Euglena or earthworm. Second one is trophotaxis. Here there are paired receptors, and these receptors will compare the, here the stimuli is the light. They will compare the light intensity coming from two different sources. They will move this way, they will move that way. They will compare the intensity and they will take a in-between path, an intermediate path. This is called as trophotaxis, as seen in planaria, which will try to move away from the light, showing negative phototaxis. Then you have telotaxis, where the orientation is direct. There is no intermediate. The animal will go to one source or to another source. So when it does that, it can go in a zigzag way. So example, hermit crab, when there's two stimuli, when there are two stimuli, the animal will move from one to another, and then it will decide where it has to go, and it will go to that stimuli. So this is called as telotaxis. If the response is based on the landmark, then you call it as pharotaxis. For example, if you look at bird migration, when they are migrating, some people believe that they will follow the landmarks. So if they are following the landmark and they are moving towards a stimuli, it is called as pharotaxis. It is meiotaxis, when the animal is moving at an angle. It's not going straight, it's going in an angle. Then it is meiotaxis. For example, homing the ants and the bees. Then next is nemotaxis. Again here, it follows the familiar landscapes. And the next one is thermotaxis. Here, temperature will act as the stimuli. Some forms like nematodes, they will migrate and they will sense very small difference of temperature, like 0.1 degree centigrade per centimeter. They are so sensitive for the variation in the temperature and they follow that. So this is called as thermotaxis. Thigmotaxis, where the animal will respond to the touch or the physical contact. Whenever a rat swims, it prefers to swim near the edge of a water maze. So it keeps touching the maze, and that will guide the rats to swim. This is called as thigmotaxis. So now we will see the different types of taxis movements. Phototaxis, where the animal is responding to the stimulus light. If it is moving towards light, it is positive phototaxis, example Euglena. If it is moving away from the light, it is negative phototaxis, example cockroach. Here you can see a picture where the light is attracting the moth, an example for positive phototaxic or phototaxis. Here the earthworm doesn't prefer light, it try to moves away from the light, an example for negative phototaxis. So earthworm is referred as negatively phototaxic. If the stimulus is chemical, you call it as chemotaxis. The response is elicited by the gradation in the chemicals. So a lot of studies has been carried out in unicellular and bacterial cultures, where they could see that the bacteria E. coli prefers to move towards the sugar in the culture medium. So if it is attracted towards a chemical, you call it as a chemoattractant. If the chemical is trying to chase away the animal, those chemicals are referred to as chemorepellents. So basically, chemotaxis is seen in prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. When the chemicals is released on the land, so it can be carried by the wind, then you call it as anemotaxis. For example, the dog pheromone is released on the land. So whenever the dog urinates, along with the urine, it passes out the pheromones, which gives some information about the status of the dog, telling whether it's a male or a female dog, whether it is reproductively mature or not. So here, the chemicals are released on the land. If you look at a silk moth, the female silk moth will release the pheromone bombicule into the air, and this bombicule has got the capacity to attract the male moth, which is quite far away. So here the chemical is released into the air. Chemicals in water, if you look at paramecium, when the paramecium is there in the water medium, if there are some toxic chemicals, they tend to move away from the chemical. You call it as phobotaxis. What is the significance of chemotaxis? The chemotaxis, where the animal tries to follow the chemicals, or either they move towards or away from the chemicals, it will help them to locate the food source. It will help them to avoid toxic substances. If you look at higher forms, it will help in the movement of the sperm in the female reproductive body so that they will be able to reach the egg and fertilize. Again, in higher forms, whenever the tissue transformation is happening, development of nervous system is happening, so the chemotaxis will help in the transformation process when the central nervous system is developing. It plays a major role in immune reactions and also in the proliferation and growth of the tumors, and especially in the cancerous cells, when they become metastatic, spreading to different parts of the body, the chemotaxis plays a role. Here you can see some pictures how the butterfly is attracted by the scent produced by the flowers. The ants, which are following the trails. If you see an ant colony, you can see the ants are moving in one straight line. That is because of the chemical pheromone which is released, and it will help them in finding the food source. A mosquito biting, if you observe in a family, the mosquito preferably will bite some people because of the chemical nature of their whatever secreted. If they have more amount of carbon dioxide, or if they have more lactic acid, then they will sense that and they try to prefer to bite such people. And you can also see the skunk, which produces an odor which is very repellent. It is called as a defensive odor, which will try to keep away the predator. So these are some examples for the chemotaxis. Next is geotaxis or gravitaxis. Here the stimuli is the specific gravity. The earth's specific gravity will act as the stimuli. Some animals prefer to move towards the earth, that is towards the gravity. They are attracted towards the earth. They start moving down towards the ground. It is called as positive geotaxis. If it moves away, if it tries to go away from the ground, if they climb up the stem of the plant or the tree, then it is negative geotaxis. So there are some examples for that. The planktonic larvae of a king crab, the scientific name Lithodes equispinus, shows for positive phototaxis but negative gravitaxis. They go towards light, but they go away from the ground. They start moving upwards. The larvae of a polychaete, Platyneris dumerili, shows positive phototaxis moving towards light, and they also show positive gravitaxis. They start moving down towards the earth. Both positive and negative gravitaxis are found in protozoans like Loxodus, then Remanella and Paramecium. Next, if the stimuli is a sound, then you call it as phonotaxis. Movement of an organism in response to a sound source is called as phonotaxis. If you look at the animal during breeding season, the male will generally make sounds to attract the female. You call this as courtship songs. So the male will sing the courtship song to attract the female, which is an example for phonotaxis. The moth has got ears on the thoracic region. If you look at the echolocation in bats have got the capacity to produce ultrasonic waves. With the help of these ultrasonic waves, they will try to catch the prey. Moth is a prey for the bat, and when the bat produces the ultrasonic waves, it will go hit the prey and it will come back. When it comes back, the bat will try to identify the echo and try to catch the prey. Whereas the moth also has got some adaptations. It has got ears on the thoracic region so that it will be able to hear the ultrasonic cry of the bats and try to move away from the bat and escape from the bat. So this picture is showing how the ultrasonic waves created by the bat is going, reaching the moth, and it will come back in the form of echo. So to avoid that, the moth, which has got ears in the thoracic region, will try to move away from the bat. Other examples, if you look at the animal kingdom, the bats and the dolphins can detect ultrasound. Bees can see ultraviolet light, which we cannot see. Moths have got very acute sense of smell, where they can even detect even if a molecule of female pheromone is released. Snakes can detect infrared light, and fishes can sense electromagnetic waves. So with this, we just went through the slides where we could study some of the examples of the first type of spatial orientation, that is taxis. Next, we will start with kinesis. Unlike taxis, kinesis is not a oriented movement. When an animal is exposed to a stimulus, it starts moving randomly without orientation, without a particular direction, and the rate of the movement depends upon the intensity of the stimuli. If the stimuli is mild, the movement is less. If the stimuli is strong, the movement is more vigorous. So one example what you can see is, when you switch on the light, the cockroach will start moving in all the directions because it's basically doesn't like light. It is negatively phototaxic. So as soon as it sees the light source, it starts moving in all the directions and try to escape from the light. Under kinesis, there are two types. First is orthokinesis. When an animal is exposed to a stimuli, it starts moving fast. The rate of the movement is proportional to the intensity of the stimuli. If the stimuli is mild, the movement is slow. If the stimuli is strong, the movement is fast. So the rate of the movement of the animal is directly proportional to the strength of the stimuli. So this is called as orthokinesis. For example, wood lice, it prefers humidity. If humidity reduces, it starts showing random movement, and it shows movement until it reaches a suitable place. The second type of kinesis is called as clinokinesis. Here, the rate of change of direction is directly proportional to the intensity of the stimulus. In the first one, it was the rate of movement, that is, either it moved fast or slow. Here, it is the rate of change of direction. When the animal is exposed to a stimulus, it starts changing the direction of its movement, which is again proportional to the intensity of the stimulus. If the stimulus is mild, it changes its direction slowly. If the stimuli is strong, it changes its direction fast. For example, if you look at paramecium in the culture, if the carbon dioxide concentration is high, paramecium starts moving fast and starts moving until it reaches a safe place. So here you can see some examples of random movement. So in the first one, you're seeing the insects which are trying to avoid the stimuli by showing random movement. And also a rat, when it comes out, rats are nocturnal animals. When it comes out in a light area, it doesn't know what it has to do. It simply moves randomly until it reaches a safe place. So with this, we completed taxis and kinesis. The next is a reflex action. What do you mean by a reflex action? A reflex is an automatic, involuntary response to a stimulus which is from outside or to an internal feedback. So to maintain homeostasis inside the body, the organism will exhibit this type of action called as reflex action. What is the benefit of exhibiting reflex action? One example what you can give for reflex action is, suppose you touch something very hot. Immediately, you are withdrawing your hand from the hot surface. Or if you step upon a sharp object, you will withdraw your leg from the sharp object. So basically, this is called as the reflex action. And by performing this reflex action, you are removing your body from the painful stimuli. Or you are trying to prevent you from falling down or injuring yourself. So this type of removing the body from a painful stimuli is an example for reflex action. If you look at internally also, body, in order to maintain homeostatic conditions, it shows some sort of behavior. So for example, when you're in a very stuffy place where there is not enough oxygen, it's not a well aerated room, it's not a well ventilated room, the body starts yawning. By doing so, you're trying to take more oxygen. So yawning is a reflex action. So like that, to maintain the oxygen level, to maintain the blood pressure, to maintain the breath rate, the body shows some sort of mechanisms to adapt, which are the reflex actions to maintain the internal homeostasis constant. Suppose you happen to swallow something and that's an irritant, it is toxic. So what the body does, it will try to remove the toxic substance by vomiting. So by doing forcible, you're bringing the food, the toxic substance out of your body forcibly by vomiting. One another example for reflex action, which is not under your control, is the change in the size of the pupil of your eye. Suppose you are in a very bright, sunny day, you're outside, and you enter a room where there is no light, it is dark, then immediately you go blind. You cannot see anything. That is because when you are outside, because of the bright light, your pupil size would have reduced to cut down the source of light entering into your eyes. When you enter the dark room, the amount of light entering the pupil is not sufficient for you to look at what is there inside. It will take some time, during which your pupil will relax so that more amount of light will enter and you will be able to see the light. Coughing, sneezing are other examples for reflexes.